We cut our break a bit short, but you have control of your computer, so you can turn it on and off as you wish. We're now going to do the questions from the February 2000 bar. Line 6. Tom is a lifelong childless bachelor. Validly executed a typed will in 1994. So since they told us the will was validly executed, we don't have any discussion about the validity of executing the will, like the 6110 material does not need to be discussed. The will said, $10,000 to my servant Sam. And the importance of that, of course, is that Sam is not a relative. And since Sam is not a relative, Sam does not have an intestate share. And if we have to distribute some of this property intestate, Sam isn't going to get anything. Line 10, number 2. My house in Oakdale to my friend Fiona. Okay? This is a house in Oakdale. Notice that it's like my house in San Francisco. Well, that's not really a street address or description of the property, it's a legal description. But if the person only has one house in Oakdale, that's okay, you can figure out which house it is. Number 3, line 12, the residue of my estate to church. Okay, no problem. Line 14, in 1996, watch your dates, that's 2 years later. 2 years later, Tom validly executed a second type will. This one providing, number 1, I hereby revoke all prior wills. Now we're told that this second will is valid, so that revocation clause at line 16 works. So I revoke all prior wills. So that destroys or revokes the 1994 will. Doesn't say we might not revive it under DRR or something, but at least for right now it is revoked. Line 18, $10,000 to my servant Sam. Okay, that didn't change anything. Item 3, line 21, my house in Oakdale to my friend Fiona. Okay, that didn't change anything. And item 4, the residue of my estate to museum. So what he really changed here was the residue from church to museum. And so far it seems perfectly valid because the will was valid, the revocation works, everything seems okay. Line 24. In 1998, okay, that's 2 years later, angered by a modern art exhibit at museum, Tom decided he preferred the provisions of the 1994 will to those of the 96 will. So he wants to go back to the 94 will. Well, he can do that. One way he can do that is he could write a new document. And the new document could say, I revoke my 96 will, and then expressly say, I revive the 94 will, I revoke the 96 and revive the 94. He could expressly say that. Or if he just revoked the 96 will and then said to people, declared, I'm glad I revoked my 96 will because now the 94 will is valid again. That's the way I want things. Or now my church is going to get something. So remember we talked about that because at 6123 it says if you have will 1 like the 94 will, and then you write a will 2 like the 96 will, and then you revoke the 96 will, does that revive the 94 will? Depends on the intent of the testator, and that intent can be expressed again by statements or circumstances. But the statements must be subsequent, must be contemporaneous or subsequent with the execution of the new will. Now, please notice that 6123C, and be sure to read it, 6123C has another provision in there that gets tested sometime I think it's C, is it C or B? 6123A says this stuff. This is A here. And then there is a, this is A. Then there's a 6123B and says, if you revoked will 2 in my hypothetical. Remember, you got a will 1, then you write a will 2 that revoked will 1, and now you revoke will 2. Did you intend to revive will 1 or not? That's your 6123 problem. The answer turns on the intent. But what we've been saying is that you can show the intent in either by statements or circumstances. But section B says, if you revoked will 2 by writing a will 3, then the intent needs to be in will 3. Okay, so here, this is how we determine the intent in the previous case. 6123A says this is how you get the intent. This is 6123A. But 6123B says if you write a will 3, if you revoke will 2 by using a will 3, then you got to put the intent in will 3. So if you have a will 3, you got to put the intent there. I hope this is readable here for a second. So I'm saying that once again, in case you can't read this, if you revoke will 2 with a will 3, then will 3 has to show the intent to revive will 1. Otherwise, you try to get the intent to revive by method A. The intent to revive, intent to revive will 1. Okay, so this brings us then back to the problem we're working on, and we're now at line 24. And line 24 says, in 1998, angered by a Martin exhibit at the museum, Tom decided that he preferred to go back to Will 1, the 94 Will. Line 25. Tom wrote by hand. So we're now looking at a holographic Will right here, 6111. Tom wrote by hand, signed and mailed the following letter to Lois's lawyer, and who had possession of the executed originals of both wills. Line 28. I hereby revoke my 96 will. Okay, well, that's okay. He can revoke his 96 will, but he's doing it by a third will. And so since he's doing it by a third will, if he intends to revive will 1, he's got to put it in this third will. So he says, line 28, I hereby revoke my 1996 will. Please destroy it. I wish my 1994 will to be in effect. And so, and then he signs it. So this qualifies, first of all, this letter qualifies as a holographic will. So you know what 6111 says, and you use 6111 to show that this letter did qualify as a holographic will. And if this letter qualified as a holographic will, then we have a will 3. And now that we have a will 3, the intent to revive will 1 must be in will 3. And what does will 3 say? Will 3 says, I hereby revoke my 96 will, please destroy it. I wish my 94 will to be in effect. So the intent to revive the 94 will is expressed there, just like it's supposed to. Also, this holographic document here, not only do you need to show that that's a will, and all of the material provisions are in the handwriting of the testator and it's signed by the testator, not only do you need to know what to show that this is a holographic will, but also don't forget that this does not dispose of any property. Line 28, all it does is simply revoke a previous will and revive another. But that's okay. You and I know that a will does not have to dispose of property. If a will either disposes of property or names an executor or revokes other wills, that's perfectly okay. And so everything that happens in line 28 is perfectly valid. Notice at line 28 that the testator also says, please destroy it. Well, it doesn't really matter whether the 96th will is destroyed or not. It's revoked. Whether it's destroyed or not, it's revoked, and the 94th will is in effect. Let's keep reading, line 34. In 1999, Tom sold a house that he had owned in Oakdale at the time that he wrote the earlier will. So now the earlier will says, my house in Oakdale to Fiona. The 94 will said that, the 96 will said that, but now he sold the house in Oakdale, and and what do you do? Well, if you make a specific devise to somebody, and that specific devise is not in the estate, then it is a deed. It's gone. And so if the estate, if the will says, my 1937 Cadillac, license number so-and-so, I hereby give to Joe, well, that's obviously a very specific gift. And if the Cadillac is missing from the estate, the common law rule is that the gift is a deed, meaning that it's gone. And so if you say, my house at 1517 Jones Street in New York is hereby given to Mary, well, and that house is no longer in the estate, the gift is a deed. That's how the common law works. Now, California has a different rule about that. California follows a minority position and says if the gift is missing, a specific gift, now this doesn't apply to general gifts, because you say, give Mary $500,000, that's not a specific gift. But, if you don't have $500,000 in the estate, then of course Mary's gift will be prorated. But if you say, give some specific thing, my baby grand piano in the living room of my house, give that to Mary and that's missing, that's when it's a deed. Now California has a special rule about that, and the California rule says that when the testator has removed property from the estate, when something is what we don't know who removed it, it's missing from the estate, that the gift is not automatically a deed, as the common law required. Instead, the person who was going to get the gift, the beneficiary who is going to get it, can trace the property received from that gift, from the Cadillac, from the painting, from the baby grand piano, from the house, whatever it was. You can trace those funds into something else if something else was bought with that money. And you get to something else. So that if the testator says, you know, my 1937 Cadillac license number so-and-so goes to Joe, and now the testator sells this Cadillac, it's an antique, and he gets $30,000 for it, and now you can show this $30,000 was used to buy a painting, then the person who was going to get the Cadillac gets the painting. You're allowed to trace. And the only thing that disrupts the tracing is if the testator intended to redeem the gift. They got rid of the Cadillac with the intent to redeem. And the person who has the burden of proof that the testator intended to redeem is on the person who does not want the beneficiary to have the car, the one who does not want the beneficiary to have the house or whatever it is. Whoever is contesting that, they have the burden of proving that the testator not only got rid of the gift, but they got rid of it with the intent to deprive the person of their of the gift, intent to redeem. So now, another thing that you can do when property is missing from the estate sometimes is that sometimes the testator in a specific gift did not intend for the gift to be identified at the time the will was written. See, ordinarily, in a specific gift, you identify the gift at the time that the will was written. Because you say, my baby grand piano to Mary. Well, the baby grand piano is right there in the living room. So you're identifying it at the time that the will is written. Person says, my Picasso, you know, that's hanging on the wall someplace. My Picasso goes to Mary. And so the gift is identified at the time that the will was written. But there are some circumstances where the person really intended for the gift to be identified at the time of death, because it's the nature of the item is something that changes often. For example, person says, if the person says, my car owned at the time of death, well, obviously that person intended for the gift to be identified at the time of death. But suppose the person didn't say, the car I owned at the time of death, but they just said, my car. Well, if you just say, my car, that did the person mean my car that I owned when I wrote the will, or my car at the time of death? Well, people change cars so often that the courts will be perfectly willing to say, well, the person probably meant whatever car I owned at the time of death. And likewise, the person says, my baby grand piano to Mary. Well, suppose the person, you know, got rid of the baby grand piano and got a grown-up adult piano instead of the baby grand. So he says, my baby grand piano to Mary, or he just says, you know, my grand piano to Mary, and the grand piano changed from the time that the will was written until the time of death. Well, if it's still a grand piano, the courts would probably say the person intended for the gift to be identified at the time of death. So we're looking for devices to prevent redemption of gifts. One device we have to prevent redemption of gifts is in California. If the gift is missing, that whoever doesn't want the beneficiary to have it has to prove that it's missing with the intent to redeem. So that's one way to save these missing gifts. Another way is to say, well, the particular gift was intended to be identified at the time of death because of the nature of that type of gift. So that's another way to save gifts that are missing from the estate. Another way is that sometimes you just change the form of the gift. It's the same gift, you change the form. It wasn't really that much of a change. You say, my painting on the wall to Mary, and the person changes the painting on the wall. Well, you can look at that as either identified at the time of death, or you can argue that it really is just a slight change in form. The better examples of change in form are those cases where the person has some stock, and these are the close cases, but there are some cases where it's worked. The person has some stock, and they have IBM stock. And they had IBM stock at the time the will was written, but then the person later sold the IBM stock because it was decreasing in value or something, and bought General Motors stock in place of it. Well, if you do that, you can argue that this is really, both of them are blue chip stocks, and the person really was just changing form, and they changed the form of the stock because of convenience, and change in form doesn't really redeem the gift. And now that's a pretty big change in form when you go from IBM stock to General Motors. But if I thought for a minute, I could think of some other examples where the change in form is not quite so large. So that's another device that you might be able to use. Change in form, it does not really redeem the gift. Another device that you might be able to use is that if the testator who wrote the will says, you know, my piano to Mary, the testator wrote the will, and then the testator became incompetent. And while the testator was incompetent, the administrator of the person's guardian, lifetime guardian, or this incompetent person, that person sold the piano. And that person sold the piano without even knowing that it was supposed to go to Mary. And so you wouldn't want that to redeem the gift. And so that's another way to save the gift. So the methods we have so far is that the guardian of the incompetent person is the one who took it out of the estate. That should not redeem the gift. Second one, that redemption, no intent to redeem. California requires intent to redeem. Third, the item can be identified at the time of death. And fourth, that a change in form arguably should not redeem the gift. Now, so getting back to our problem, in our problem you see that at line 31, Lois receives the letter via U.S. mail at her office. Line 31, after reading the letter, she tore up the 1996 will in half, but preserved the pieces for future reference. Well, she tore up the 1996 will, but please notice that the 1996 will was already revoked. It's revoked by the line at line 28 that says, I hereby revoke it. So it's already revoked. So what the lawyer Lois tore up was not really a will anymore, just some pieces of paper. Also, notice that tearing up the will, if you want to revoke by tearing it up, like I did, revoke by 6120B, if you're going to revoke by a physical act of tearing up the will, you have to do it in the presence of, if someone else is going to do it for the testator, if someone else is going to do it for the testator, they have to do it in the presence of the testator and at the direction of the testator. And here, Lois tore up this will, the 1996 will, at the direction of the testator, but not in the presence of the testator. And so, there's two reasons why destroying the 1996 will did not revoke it. First is it was already revoked, and secondly, it didn't comply with 6120B in any case. You can see the importance of reading these code sections. You see all that little stuff that's in there that you might otherwise miss. Okay, this brings us into line 34. Line 34 says, in 1999, Tom sold the house that he had owned in Oakdale at the time that he wrote the earlier will and purchased another house in Oakdale. Well, there you have, you would say that the house in Oakdale is a specific gift, and you try to save it by those devices that we just talked about. You use as many of them as you can. Certainly, you'd argue no intent to deem. You would argue that change in form. You'd argue intent to identify the house at the time of death. That brings us to line 35. Also in 1999, Sam died intestate. So Sam is the person, the servant, who was getting $10,000 and he left no children. Now, if Sam died first, he's going to get nothing. He's got to survive the testator. So if Sam doesn't survive the testator, that is one of these code sections here. Section 21109, I'm going to add that to the list here. 21110, I'm going to add a new one here. 21109. Is a section that says that in a will, the beneficiary has to survive the testator. The beneficiary has to survive the person in order to take anything. And up here, this is the intestate one, saying that if you want to take intestate, you got to survive the decedent by 120 hours. Here you just have to survive them. And clear and convincing evidence in both cases. So here in our problem, Sam is the servant who is about to receive $10,000. But 21-109 says, let's take a look at 21-109. 21-109 right here, this one, says a transferee. Now the transferee is in the person who is the devisee, taking it out of the, getting the property from the will. The transferee, the head of this section, by the way, 21-109, the title is Failure to Survive by Transferee. The transferee is the devisee. So failure to survive, and so what it says is, a transferee who fails to survive the transferor. Transferor is the person writing the will and giving away the property. At death, I'll read it again, I'm sorry. A transferee who fails to survive the transferor of an at-death transfer or until any future time required. So if the transferor says you got to survive for 2 weeks, then you get worse. Does not take under the instrument. So you got to survive. And then 21-109B says clear and convincing evidence is the test. Clear and convincing evidence. Our Sam, our person Sam in this problem of the February 2000 exam, our person Sam did not survive. And so under 21-109, he's going to get nothing. Now, you know, of course, that the anti-lapse statutes will apply if the person who failed to survive was kin. And so we understand that there's an anti-lapse statute, but the anti-lapse statute is not going to apply to Sam because Sam is not kin. He told you he was not. So picking up then at line 35, also in 1999, Sam died intestate, survived only by two children. Well, it doesn't matter. Sam isn't going to get anything. Tom died in 2000, survived by Fiona. Now, Fiona's supposed to get the house, and we decided we're going to let her have it. Sam's two children, well, it doesn't matter. Sam isn't going to get anything, and anti-lapse will not apply to get it to his children. And a nephew named Ned, who would be Tom's sole heir if he died intestate. Well, Tom did not die intestate. He died with the 1994 will intact. Tom's net estate consisted of his house. We know what to do with the house, give it to Fiona. His stocks, what do we do with the stocks? Well, the stocks we didn't mention stocks specifically, so it's going to go in with the residue to the 1994 will. It's going to go to the church. Bonds, that's going to go to the church. 150,000 savings account, and that is going to go to the church. Okay, and that's the end of this question. Let's look at the next question. Let's look at the question from the July 2000 exam. July 2000. In the July 2000 exam, it proceeds as follows. Line 6, this is about Hal, Wanda, Frank, Stan, and Don. And line 6, in 1996, Hal, married to Wanda, created a trust that he created a trust that he funded with $200,000 of his separate property. Okay, so hell creates a trust, separate property, he can do what he wants to do with his separate property, and we have the trust. This brings us to line 7. Trustee Inc. was named as a trustee. Okay, so Tom gave $200,000 to Trustee Inc. We're now at line 7. And the Trustee Inc. was directed at line 7 to pay the income to Hal for life, okay, the remainder to Wanda. Income to Hal for life, remainder to Wanda. Okay, no real problem there. He sets up a trust and he can do that. Line 8, just get a good image of what's going on. There's nothing gone wrong. This is background, but the background information is obviously very important. Line 8, at the same time, Hal executed a valid will. The will is valid, so don't waste our time with formation. And the valid will had these three provisions in it. Number 1, $20,000 to my friend Frank. Now, when you see property being given to friends and servants and people who are identified by the bar examiner as being non-relatives, then you can see that what's going to happen is that you're going to be given a chance to use the anti-lapse, and you should not use the anti-lapse statutes for non-relatives. And Frank is a non-relative. And the main reason for telling you somebody is a relative or a non-relative is anti-lapse. And so when you see them identifying someone as a non-relative, then you know that an anti-lapse issue is coming up. So Article 1 is $20,000 to Frank. Article 2, $35,000 to the person named on a sheet of pink paper dated December the 31, 1989, located in my top desk drawer. Now, this is obviously an attempt to incorporate by reference. And so we're going to have to use incorporation by reference right here, 6130. And to incorporate something by reference, what's it going to take to successfully incorporate by reference? And the answer is that you successfully incorporate by reference if you, number one, intend to do so. That's a big deal. You have to intend to do it. Number two, obviously, you got to identify the document that you intend to incorporate by reference. Number three, the document must actually be in existence at the time. Okay, it can't be something that you're going to change later or doesn't exist later. You're going to create it later. It's got to exist right now. And so that's the third requirement. The document must be in existence. And the fourth requirement is that at the time of the probate, somebody's got to come forward with the page 15 of the phone book, of the New York phone book, and say, this is the page, this is the item that was identified in the will. Okay. And so line 12 in Article 2, we might attempt to use incorporation by reference to get that in there. Let's see, could we get it in? Is there intent to incorporate? Well, it looks like there is. Secondly, was the document already in existence? Well, yes, the dates tell us that. Was the document adequately identified? To the person named on a pink sheet of paper located at this spot. Well, you can give a brief discussion about whether or not that is sufficiently identified to identify a particular piece of paper, and was that paper ultimately found in the place where it is supposed to be? That's the authentication part. At the probate, somebody's got to show up and authenticate. This is the document described in the will. And so for incorporation by reference, on Article 2 at line 12 of this problem, we have the intent, we have the document in existence. Is the document adequately described? Given some discussion about that. And was the document found where they said it was going to be? And in other words, can you authenticate what they ultimately brought to court as this? And we'll get some facts, and you need to discuss that also. Okay, continuing, then this brings us to Article 3, line 16. Article 3, line 16 says, the residue of the estate to my son, Stan. Okay, no problem. Stan gets the residue. Line 19. In 1998, watch your dates, this is 2 years later, 2 years after the first will. In 1998, Wanda executed a valid will solely in favor of her son, Stan. Well, Wanda can do that. She can give everything she wants to her son, Stan. Remember that what Wanda can dispose of is all of her separate property in any way that she wants, and she can dispose of half of the community property in any way she wants, but she cannot dispose of half of the community property. So at line 18, when Wanda executed a will solely in favor of her son, she can do that, and what she can give her son is all of her separate property if she wants to, and up to half of the community property, and that's all. Line 18, continuing. Shortly thereafter, Wanda died while giving birth to the couple's second child, Don. That's interesting. So Wanda is giving birth to Don and died in the process. Well, it looks like the child, Don, is an afterborn child. Don is an omitted child. Don is going to qualify right here under this section dealing with the omitted child, 21620. And because the child was born or adopted after her will was written, she wrote her will in 1998 and then died thereafter. And so the child was born after the will was written. That's what 21620 says. And therefore, this child, whose name is Don, should get an intestate share. That's what 621 says. The child gets an intestate share, okay, unless one of those requirements, exceptions are met. Take a look at what these exceptions say. It says 21621. Heading, we're looking at right here, 21621, this code section. And this code section says the title, Reasons for a Child Not to Receive a Share. Okay, reason for a child not receive a share. And what are the reasons? There are three reasons the child might not receive a share, in spite of the fact that Don is qualified under 6120 as being left out. The reason the child may not get a share is, one, the decedent's failure to provide for the child in the decedent's testamentary instrument was intentional, and that intention appears from the testamentary instrument. Well, that didn't happen here because Wanda did not mention in her 1998 will that I don't want to give my next born child anything. Okay, so doesn't fit that. So we don't leave Don out because of Section A. Section B, so this one right here, this has got an A, B, and C. 6121 A, B, and C. We just looked at 6121 A. We're not going to leave Don out because of that. 6120 B. The decedent had one or more children and devised or otherwise directed the disposition of substantially all of the estate to the other parent of the omitted child. Well, that's when she didn't give all of her estate to the surviving parent. Okay, Wanda gave it all to Stan. And so So far, looks like Don's going to get an intestate chair. 6120 says give her an intestate chair unless A, B, or C under 21. So A didn't happen, B didn't happen, let's look at C. The decedent provided for the child by transfer outside the estate, passing by the decedent's testamentary instrument and the intention that the transfer be in lieu of a provision in said instrument is shown by statements of the decedent or from the amount of transfer or other evidence. In other words, that's the section. You should read it carefully. But 6121C, that's the one that says, if you created a trust for the omitted child, or gave a large gift to the omitted child, or did something for the omitted child, so that in lieu of the child taking from the will. Well, Don is the omitted child, and Don doesn't fit under 6120A, B, or C. So Don should get her intestate chair. What is her intestate chair? Don's intestate chair is one half of the mother's separate property, and Don, her child, has no intestate chair of the receives no intestate share of the half of community property, because if the other parent is surviving, the children have no intestate share rights in the community property. It all goes to the surviving spouse intestate. And so the two kinds of property that Wanda was able to give away, her separate property and community property, Don is entitled to her intestate share of those. Don's intestate share of community property is zero. Don's intestate share of Wanda's separate property is one half. So let's continue. We're now at line 21. It says later in 1998, so this is after Wanda died. Later in 1998, while grieving Wanda's death, Hal regularly consulted a fortune teller, Florence. In 1999, based on Florence's predictions that Sam would become a criminal, Hal executed a codicil. Well, a codicil is just an amendment to a will. He executed a codicil, changing the residuary from his son Sam to Florence. So we see that Hal changed the will, where instead of Sam getting the residue like he was in the will, Sam gave the residue to his fortune teller. Now, so we have a problem there, and let's take a look at that. If Sam changed the will and gave property to the fortune teller Hal changed the will and gave property to the fortune teller instead of the residue to his son, we think the fortune teller probably exercised either fraud or undue influence. So we need to know what are the rules about that, so we can see if she did that. So we begin with with fraud. And so the fraud by Florence is what we're looking at here. And the way you might do this, there are several ways to establish fraud. One is there is a statutory scheme at 6112. Okay, and 6112, you recall, is this provision right here. this is the interested witness case. And so, in the case 6112, interested witness, I'm sorry, I'm going to write it again here. 6112 is the interested witness, and from that you get a presumption. So 6112, the one we talked about, where if a person has is one of the, if the person is one of the people who signed the will. They sign the will, and so they become, and they also are beneficiary. As a presumption against them, the fraud, undue influence, menace, duress, and that presumption against them is rebuttable, of course. And the person who is the interested witness then either has to rebut the presumption, and if they fail to rebut the presumption, then what they get is the lesser of what they would have gotten from this will, or what they would have gotten without this will. And what they would have gotten without this will could be intestate, if they would have gotten something intestate, if they were a relative. If they're not a relative, their intestate share would be zero. But if there was a previous will, you look at the previous will. So the way the code reads, if you read it carefully, 6112, it says that the interested witness gets what they would have gotten from this will, or what they would have gotten if this will had not been established, the lesser of those two. And if this will had not been established, then if this will, if this new will had not been established, then what would the person have gotten? Well, if there was no previous will, the person would have gotten their intestate share. And if there was a previous will, they may have gotten something from the previous will. So that's how they read. So this is one way to end up with fraud. There's a presumption. This presumption right here is a presumption of a lot of bad stuff. Presumption of fraud, undue influence, and so forth. So that's one way to get fraud, undue influence, menace, duress, is by this. We do not have this in the case of Florence. Another way is intentional misrepresentation, which caused the provision. And the will. Again, if someone intentionally misrepresents a fact, but that intentional fact, caused them to catch the wrong bus, that's not the same as an intentional fact that caused them to put something in the will they would not otherwise have put there. So don't forget this causation. Intentional misrepresentation which caused the provision in the will, and that's another way to get fraud. Another way to get it is with CUP. C-U-P. Now this cup, some say this creates a presumption of undue influence, some say presumption of fraud, so probably varies from jurisdiction. So the C stands for confidential relationship. The U stands for unnatural result. And the P stands for participated in the execution. of the will. So if you have all three of these, not one or the other, you need all three of these. If you have all three of these, then this creates a presumption. And the presumption is either presumption of fraud or presumption of undue influence. Depending on the jurisdiction you're in. So this is another way to get fraud. And finally, another way to get undue influence is mnemonic S-O-D-U. So the S is susceptible. Opportunity, disposition, and unnatural results. Once again, undue influence. The fact is so do, susceptible, opportunity, disposition, unnatural result. Now what happens here is that if you have these four, this does not create a presumption. Like over here, cup creates a presumption of either fraud or undue influence depending on the jurisdiction that you're in. Okay. So over here under cup, this creates a presumption, whereas back over here under undue influence, if you have so do, this does not create a presumption like you have here. This undue influence, what it does is let me give you an example. Let's suppose that the housekeeper, you claim that the housekeeper who was there taking care of the disabled person was overbearing and really caused the person to change their will and to name the housekeeper and got rid of all the children out of the will and put the housekeeper in there. What do you do when you go to court and you try to prove that that's what the housekeeper did? Well, you can always go to court and claim somebody committed undue influence. You can pick anybody and go to court and say this person exercised undue influence. And the deal is, at what point, how much undue influence do you have to have? How much evidence of undue influence do you have to have before this becomes a jury question? Okay, if all you have is just sort of some blank accusations of undue influence, that's not even a jury question yet. But how much evidence of this undue influence do you need before it becomes a jury question? In other words, before you reach the point where the jury is permitted to infer undue influence, permitted to infer. How much evidence do you have before the jury is permitted to infer undue influence? And that's called an inference. This evidence creates an inference. It doesn't mean that the jury must infer undue influence. It means that once you have so do, the jury is now permitted. So that you get to the jury. This is just enough to get you to the jury. And so, what do you have to have to get to the jury? The decedent needs to be susceptible to undue influence. This is usually caused because the person is elderly, bad memory, disabled, dependent, blind, anything of that sort that makes them more susceptible to undue influence. Opportunity, housekeeper obviously had the opportunity to unduly influence. Disposition means one of two things. Under disposition, either the person had an overbearing personality, I've seen it used that way, so they had a disposition to unduly influence, or the disposition also has been used where if the housekeeper, in my example, benefited from the will. If the housekeeper benefited, that's enough to give her the disposition to undo the influence. So the disposition has been used as, did the person influence? Pardon me. Did the person benefit? If so, that satisfies the disposition requirement. Or does the person have an overbearing personality? That will satisfy this. And then finally, the unnatural result. Well, in my hypo, giving none of the money to the children and the housekeeper gets it all is clearly a case of an unnatural result. So if you have this, this is enough to get you to the jury. Now, with all that in mind, let's look at the rest of this question. This question says that Hal, at line 23, he changed the residuary from San to Florence. And we're going to claim that that was the product of either fraud or undue influence by the housekeeper Florence. We don't have this. Florence doesn't qualify for this because she was not an interested witness. We don't have any. Well, did Florence intentionally misrepresent? Sure she did. She committed intentional misrepresentation, which caused the provision in the will. So spell this out in detail. Deal with it. Next, do you have this one? Well, Florence and Hal have a confidential relationship. You can spell that out and explain that. Unnatural result, leaving the son out altogether, is an unnatural result. But you do not have any evidence that that Florence participated in the execution. Often the way you get this kind of evidence is a person signed the will. For example, the testator might have written a holographic will and the housekeeper signed it. Well, the housekeeper's signature was not necessary at all, but it shows the housekeeper was there participating in the execution. But we don't have any evidence of this. So we don't get a presumption based on cup, but you do have enough here to get to the jury on this. So here you can get to the jury on undue influence, and here you have evidence of this one right here. Finally comes line 25. In 2000, Hal and Frank, passengers on a commercial plane, were simultaneously killed when the plane exploded on takeoff. Well, Frank is a non-relative, and we know the deal with Frank. Frank must survive, because right here, 21-109, Frank did not survive. You need clear and convincing evidence that Frank survived. If Frank had been an intestate taker, you'd need the 120 hours, but he's not. He's taken from the will. And so they died in the airplane together, so Frank is going to get nothing because you do not have clear and convincing evidence. And finally, at line 26, the pink sheet of paper referred to says, to my next born child, if any, to 35,000, to my next born child, if any. And so Hal is Don an omitted child with regard to Hal's will? We know that with regard to Wanda's will, Don was an omitted child because Wanda wrote a will and gave everything to Stan and then died. And Don qualified as an omitted child as to Wanda's will. As to Stan's will, well, Stan wrote a will, but he made a provision for the omitted child. And so the child, it said, to my next born, if any, 35,000. And so it looks like that under 21.621C, 21.621A says, if you intentionally omitted the omitted child, and it shows in the instrument saying you purposely omitted them. 21.621B says if you gave it all to the other spouse, and 21.621C says if you gave the child something in lieu of them taking from the gift. Well, it looks like in lieu of them taking from the will. So it looks like the pink, if you did the pink piece of paper gets into the will. If the pink piece of paper we're talking about gets in as an incorporation by reference, okay, if it gets in, then it looks like the child Don has been provided for. 21.621C says, you know, this was in lieu of giving something to her. Now, so it looks like Don is not an omitted child as to Hal. However, take a look at one more thing, and that is that Wanda gets the remainder of the trust. Wanda was to get $200,000 because the trust says to Hal for life, remainder to Wanda. Well, to Hal for life, remainder to Wanda, but Wanda died first. And if Wanda died first, then what? Well, you don't apply anti-lapse because this is a Hal's wife. And the anti-lapse statute applies to kin. Anti-lapse applies to kin, applies to your brothers and sisters, your parents, your cousins. Okay, and it also applies not only to your kin, that is the kin of the deceased, but it applies to the kin of the person's spouse, but does not apply to the spouse. So your spouse's children, your spouse's mother, your spouse's grandchildren, your spouse's cousins, your spouse's siblings, but not the spouse. And so here, the remainder that goes to Wanda, okay, will not go to Wanda because she died first. And so, since that was never this, and the estate says the residue to my son, pardon me, so yeah, Hal says the residue to my son, and the $200,000 from the trust is now put back into the estate, and that's going to go to his son. And so the $200,000 goes to his son. That means that Don, should be $35,000, because Don's going to get $35,000 from being omitted, Don was omitted, but provided for in 21.621C. Remember, right here, I'm going to get rid of these apply, but I just want to be clear here. 21.621, let's be sure we got this clear. There's an A, B, and C section. Okay. A section, you intentionally omitted. Well, he didn't intentionally omit the child, and it showed from the documents. He didn't give substantially everything to, did he give substantially everything to the other spouse? This is the point we wanted to make here. That Hal gave $200,000 to Stan. This went to Stan because the will says residue to Stan. So this goes to Stan. So, and besides, there was no surviving spouse. So he did not give, Hal did not give substantially everything to the other surviving spouse. And so, but he did, the pink sheet of paper is that giving property to Don in lieu of Don getting something from the will. Well, that's what it looks like. But she sure didn't get very much. She got $35,000, and Stan got the $200,000 and any other property that they had. So is that enough? Is $35,000 right here, to this section C, is $35,000 enough to believe that he was giving her that in lieu of her getting anything else from the will? Or is it too small? And you just need to discuss that. Okay. So that takes care of this question. And with that, we will take a break and come back and do our next question. Again, we will probably not take the full 10-minute break, so we'll finish a little early because we can leave out the breaks here since you're playing these at your own pace.
Let's take a short break.